Papers, Please has a simple Orwellian story with a surprising amount of depth. In a bleak, dystopian setting, you're an immigration inspector. Meanwhile, you're also the head of a family, and their survival depends on you. Without enough money, you will all either freeze, starve, or fall badly ill with no hope of medicine. Your job is your lifeline for all of you. Yet, your wages are tiny. 5 credits per applicant processed correctly. Worse yet, the credentials required grow as the government's policies become more stringent. And you'll be penalized if you allow any people through the border crossing without proper clearance. Some of the applicants for entry are in desperate straits, which gives the tale decent tension. On top of that, there are attacks, offered bribes, secret organizations, and other things to contend with. How you use your position and its power is up to you, but it's clear that discretion is advised, as you're always being watched and judged. The writing is well balanced. If it went too far into tedium, then the story wouldn't be interesting enough. However, if the tale's not tedious, then it would no longer be a puzzle game based on documentation, but become an adventure game instead. To walk that line, the story adds in just enough exciting moments to help ease the tedium, but not enough of them to make the game a wild ride either. You're not James Bond here, you're Joe Schmo, and the plot keeps that mood going well, despite the occasional moment of excitement. The player can never forget that their job is that of an immigration inspector, or that stepping out of line could mean job loss, death, or worse. Meanwhile, many clever events in the game are based around realistic attitudes. For example, if you hang up your child's drawing at work, then you're criticized for your unprofessional attitude. If you want to play a fuck around and find out with your dystopian boss, then you can, and something will happen. The story can end in 20 different ways. It even has a dark, especially apt ending, where total tedium can be an actual reward. If you're obedient to your dystopian overlords, you can keep your job, and thus unlock endless mode. Despite the game's many strong points, it is weak on the character side of things, simply because the family of the PC gets no real development. Even a random guard at work gets more of a touching backstory. However, the overall tale itself and the gameplay are both strong enough to help compensate for this. The gameplay. Papers, Please is a highly niche puzzle game. If you enjoy Spot the Difference style puzzles, then there's a high chance that you'll find it challenging and fun. If you don't, then it may feel like doing busy work. But really, that is exactly the point. It's meant to feel like busy work. Even if you enjoy spotting differences, the puzzle mechanic will eventually seem tedious towards the end of a playthrough. This is because the entire idea behind the game is that you're a paper pusher in a dystopia. You check documents at the border, react accordingly, are paid low wages, offered bribes, and while you confiscate passports and do other tasks, you are in constant danger of being confiscated yourself by your bosses. This is why its short playtime is perfect. You can easily finish a run in 4 to 5 hours without getting too bored. The days in game are short, but they feel longer, so this works really well. The timing's well done. And with 20 different endings, that gives replayability value. Some endings can happen when the player dies prematurely, which means that some playthroughs are shorter than others. I've read that it can take around 16 hours to get all of the endings done, and that sounds about right to me. Its core matching mechanic is well done, too. What needs to be checked grows in complexity as days pass. Meanwhile, wrong choices feel tense because of its delayed notification system. When a player makes a mistake, then there's no immediate ding, no sign. It takes a few seconds before the NPC leaves the booth and passes a second checkpoint behind your station. At that point, the player is notified if and how they failed. You're never told how the government knows you failed, but given that this is an Orwellian society, it makes sense that this is a compression of what would happen over time, that eventually your mistakes would be discovered since the society is so heavily based on paperwork. So, from a gaming standpoint, it makes perfect sense, and from a story standpoint, it still does. I think it's realistic enough. I think it's also a nice Orwellian touch because it underlines the notion that whatever you do is being scrutinized at all times. And at the end of every day, your progress is saved. When it comes to the gameplay, my criticism is similar to the story part, because the family survival is intended to be a mechanic to consider, but the members seem like empty vessels, both from a story and gameplay perspective. I think that not utilizing a minigame or some other mechanic here, such as deciding whether or not to report a neighbor, was a lost opportunity for home life aspects. After all, a stressful and demanding work life would put pressure on the inspector's home life as well, especially since the state can arrest entire families if something goes awry with one member, and you do have a rather rather large family. Plus, the neighbors are spying on you. So knowing all of that's going on and having no mechanics that reflect that seems weak both from a story and gameplay perspective. It's an opportunity to add just a touch more. However, too much focus here would have detracted from the day job, which was meant to be the primary focus. It's just that having nothing much to do at home was a weak point, not that there needed to be a ton. But look, I think its design shows very well that flashy graphics aren't always necessary to make a game look good. A style simply needs to match whatever the story and gameplay require and look good overall. Its simple graphics truly fit it. Here, a minimalist look combined with a bleak color palette and fluid movement works perfectly well. When reviewing the game, I wondered if anything could be improved, but I don't think so. Attention to detail in this game is impressive. The level's high. For instance, the nature of the game is even cleverly shown in the title. It's a simple start, marching along until it's in the center, but once there, the logo acts as if it's stamping things, in tune to the theme song. The sound. The soundtrack only has a few songs, but its theme song is great. Its unique tune is instantly identifiable by those who have played the game. Its sound effects also fit it perfectly, from the simple sounds, such as stamping, to the dystopian garble of the speakers, telling you how Ars Totska welcomes you. Plus, it even cleverly uses the absence of sound to convey a major point of gloom. As an inspector, you don't only get zero appreciation from your boss, but you also get no flashy reinforcement as a player, which is typical in most games. Normally, when you solve a puzzle, clear a line, gather a coin, or do something else right in a video game, then you usually hear a happy little ding, some sort of positive reinforcement noise. This game gives you no noise when you do well. Instead, you only get a noise when you fail, meaning it has negative reinforcement in its sound only, and no positive reinforcement. That's just such an impeccable touch for a dystopia, and I love this level of attention to detail. I don't think its sound could be any better. Many musical pieces, or even a dark orchestral version of its theme, would ruin the stark simplicity that this game attempts to convey in all forms, its soundscape included. The fact that its theme song managed to be iconic while remaining simple is also a testament to how fitting the sounds are for this game. But if you do want to hear complex covers of its songs, the fanbase has your back. Just do a YouTube search. There are dozens of covers on various instruments. Final thoughts. While Papers, Please is relatively simple, it's surprisingly good. It clearly has a lot of heart put into its numerous nuances, and it accomplished almost everything that it set out to do. Its weakest point is simply in underlining the family dynamic, which, clearly, was supposed to help drive the player's motivations. Yet, its strongest points are many, and revolve around its solid melding of both detailed gameplay and detailed story. I was especially impressed in how it used basic psychology in order to enhance its soundscape. Its overall design is just incredibly strong. All in all, that makes it a unique puzzle game with heart, which also conveys an Orwellian sense of existence, which is an odd contrast, but I think it was enjoyable. A document inspecting simulator with tension, interesting additions, a variety of endings, some emotional aspects, and the clear passion of its creator for making a quality, detailed game. Meanwhile, its look and sound completely support its aesthetic in a way where I can't think of anything that the maker could have done better. It's an impressive indie game, which has won a lot of awards, but definitely one that's not for everybody given its core mechanics. Personally, I liked it, and I can see why it won a lot of awards. The game came out back in 2013, so since it's a 10-year-old game, it often does go on sale. It's usually about $10, but if you grab it on sale, then it's about $2. It doesn't have mod support, so what you pay for is what you get, and if English isn't your main language or you want to get this for a friend or somebody, it does come in 15 different ones. Along with English, there's French, German, Spanish, Portuguese, Russian, Italian, Japanese, Polish, Ukrainian, Czech, simplified Chinese, Turkish, Basque, and Korean. Content-wise, I think it'd be fine for kids. There's nothing really risque or violent since the graphics are pretty simple. There is some violence, but it's pixelated. There is some basic nudity on the body scanners, which can be unchecked in the settings. I've obviously had to do that to not have to censor this video because YouTube, but that's it. Given its core mechanic, I think it might be a little too hard for very little kids, just because there's a lot of spell checking and verification and things like that. But I can see some kids who are a bit precocious maybe getting into it earlier than others, maybe as young as 6 years old. I would guess somewhere between 6 to 10 years old, kids could probably handle it just fine.